गणानां त्वा गणपतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पतानः शृण्वन्नोतिभिः सीदसादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात्परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। ओम् आप्यायन्तु ममाङ्गानि वाक् प्राणश्चक्षुश्रोत्रमथो बलमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि सर्वं ब्रह्म उपनिषदं माहं ब्रह्म निराकुर्यां मा ब्रह्म निराकरोत् अनिराकरणमस्त्वनिराकरणं मेऽस्तु। तदात्मनि निरतेय उपनिषत्सु धर्मास्ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु। ओम शांति शांति शांति। डियर फ्रेंड्स, वी आर इन दिस सेवेंथ मंत्र ऑफ द फोर्थ पार्ट केना केनोपनिषद द फोर्थ खंड द सेवेंथ मंत्र। वी आर इन द मिडल ऑफ दिस भाष्यम। द मंत्र इज उपनिषदं भो ब्रूहीत्युक्तात उपनिषद। लेट मी रीड प्रॉपरली। उपनिषदं भो ब्रूहीत्युक्तात उपनिषद ब्राह्मीं वावत उपनिषदम अब्रूमेति। दिस इज द मंत्र। सो दिस वी आर इन द मिडल ऑफ दिस भाष्यम। दि कॉन्टेक्स्ट इज दैट द एंड ऑफ द होल टीचिंग आफ्टर द एंटायर टीचिंग ऑफ द उपनिषद हैज बीन ओवर देन दि स्टूडेंट इज आस्किंग ए क्वेश्चन। द स्टूडेंट इज आस्किंग ए क्वेश्चन। ही वॉन्ट्स टू नो वेदर दिस सब्जेक्ट कॉल्ड ब्रह्म विद्या इट He is also dependent on any other factors like karma, upasana or something like that. So that is the question of the student. Or we may look at it this way, that the Upanishad itself is putting these words into the mouth of this student. Upanishad is making the student ask, because the Upanishad also, or rather the Upanishadic Rishi, the Rishi who has seen this Upanishad, he is also aware of all the popular misconceptions. The people's people are so fixated to karma, upasana and all these things. So people do not want to get out of that. So they are more comfortable with that. So the Upanishadic sage, he is aware of all that and probably he is putting the words into the mouth of this student. So that is why we can look at it. So there was a discussion on whether karma is relevant. Karma is a part of this Brahma Vidya. We saw two words called Shesha and Sahakari. Whether it is a shesha, karma, whether it is a shesha. Shesha means an integral part. Shesha, sheshi, I explained to you in the last class. Whereas Anandagiri also has given a clarification. Shesha means phalopakari angam, an integral part which is needed for getting the final result. So that is how it is defined. Then sahakari. Sahakari is, though it is secondary, it deserves to be associated. So this shesha or sahakari. So this Brahma, karma and upasana, tapas, etc., etc., do they form part of this Brahma Vidya, or at least do they form some sort of accompaniments along with this Brahma Vidya? Are they to be associated with this Brahma Vidya? That is the question. So the basic discussion is Brahma Vidya is something which is a matter of understanding. It is a question of understanding. Brahma Vidya is based on Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana. First of all, of course, the primary requirement, the bottom line is that one should have a pure mind. The mind which has been purified over a period of time by doing Nishkama Karma, by doing yoga, by devotion, all these things, they are all like detergents. They are like detergents. So you use a soap when you are in the bathroom. So you are in the bathtub and then you use all over the body, there you are, that lather is there and then you use that soap. But once you get out, you don't come out along with that only and go into the market. You wipe off all those things and then put on some other dress and then you get into the market. So that is the duty of karma, upasana, etc. That is for chitta shuddhi. It is like a detergent. Swami Akhandananda, he calls this thing detergent. Karma, etc. It is something like a detergent. And after that thing is, after it does its job, you wash off the detergent also. It does its job, no doubt, but after it does its job, you also wash off the detergent. So that is the role of karma, that is the role of upasana. So karma and jnanam cannot be confused. Jnanam is something where a pure mind tries to look into itself, and then that pratyagatma, what is the inner self, and it tries to understand the Upanishadic statements. That is what is Shravana. Tries to understand logically. That is what is Manana. And then tries to be in that frame of mind in a very steady manner. That is what is Nididhyasana. That is internalization or application of those lines to oneself. Anusandhanam, Brahma Anusandhanam, applying those lines to oneself. So all these things, it is a totally different activity. It has nothing to do with this karma. Karma is something where I am karma. What is karma? An action. Action means there is an actor, there is a doer, there is an action. There is somebody else who is receiving the fruit, or I myself may be receiving the fruit. So there is a subject, there is an object, there is a predicate. So karta, karakam, we have come across this word karakam. So in grammar, we have seen this kartrukaraka, karmakaraka, karanakaraka, apadanakaraka, etc., etc., all those things, the relationship between the noun and the verb. So those different forms of relations, so many types of relationship are there between the karma, between the karta and the verb, and the action, isn't it? So all those things, they presuppose, what is that frame of mind? They presuppose the notion of duality. I am here, I am doing an action, I am going to achieve something. That is that notion of incompleteness, that notion of apurnata, apurnatvam, or incompleteness, the notion of unfulfillment is there in this person. Whereas a jnani, he is purnamada, purnamidam, purnat, purnamudachyate, he is in that state. So sarvata samplutodaka sthaniyah, that is what Gita also says. What is that line? Yavanartha vadapane sarvata samplutodake. So he is in that sarvata samplutodaka sthana. He is a person who is filled. That is, his individual ego has gone, and then he has expanded his self to the level of Brahman. So it is an expanded self. He is no longer in his limited ego. So when this is the difference between karma and what is this, jnanam and karma, how can you say that karma should also be there? So that is the view of this die-hard ritualist, a die-hard mimamsaka, who does not want to give up all those things, who is fixated to that, or rather addicted to that. Okay, you do karma as a jnani, that is a different thing. When you do karma as a jnani, you are not having that notion of I. You are doing it as a sort of prarabdha, like King Janaka. King Janaka, he is a jnani, but then by prarabdha, he is a king. He can't abdicate his responsibility. So he is doing it without the notion of that I. So he is doing it as an instrument of the God. He is doing it, of course, now he has crossed that level of nishkama karma, but then still he is doing at that level. In the sense that though he is a jnani, he is doing it, he is giving a sort of helping hand to the Lord. He is doing it as an instrument of the God. So that is the difference between karma, a jnani doing a karma, and an ordinary man doing karma. So you can do karma, you may do karma, but then you can't have the notion of I. You can't have that, that kartrutva bhavana. So this jnanam, which is complete in itself, jnanam is something which is complete in itself. It does not need anything to fill it. Jnanam means you are at that level of Brahma. You don't require anything else to be added on to you. To infinity, you can't add anything. Whereas karma is something which is done at the level of an imperfect man, an incomplete person who wants to attain something, who wants something else to fulfill for his fulfillment, for his strengthening. So these two things can't fit in. So that is the discussion, overall discussion. And we were in this passage. Satyam vaktavyam uchyate. Oh, yeah, the Purva Pakshi was putting a question. The next mantra, okay, it is going to say that tasya itapo damaha karmeti pratishtha. So that next mantra is going to say, the next mantra is going to prescribe tapas, dama, etc., etc. Then how are you going to say that karma is not part and parcel of this jnanam? So the Siddhanti is saying, okay, this the next mantra, no doubt it is telling about it, but it is not telling it as part and parcel of this jnanam. It is telling it as some sort of preliminary say means for cleaning, for chitta shuddhi, for the purity of, for attaining the purity of mind. It is some sort of preliminary requirement. So basic thing is, you have to appear in the election. if you want to be, if you want to contest in the election, you should be a citizen of the country, number one. You should not have a criminal record. This is a fundamental requirement. Thereafter, okay, all your merit, etc., that's a totally different thing. So there is what is called a fundamental requirement, isn't it? So this tapas, say this this nishkama karma, all these things, this pure, not even that, purity of mind is a fundamental requisite. It is a fundamental requirement. Purity of mind is a fundamental requirement. You attain that purity of mind by any process. Once you have cleaned the say mirror, there is no need for the towel and detergent again. What is needed is you have to look into the mirror, or you have to put some light onto the mirror so that you get the reflection. So when you want reflection, what is needed is the preliminary thing is cleaning. But the cleaning only, cleaning need not be permanently there. Once you have cleaned, it is over. Then it is your job to look into that mirror. So that is the say reply which is being given by the Siddhanti. They are neither Shesha nor Sahakari. So, but then the Purvapakshi was saying, these are read on par with Veda, etc. Okay, even Veda, it is only a Upaya, not a Shesha or Sahakari. Of course, this is a very, very strong statement which Shankaracharya is making, which many of our Veda Pandits may not digest. they may not be able to digest, because Veda Pandit, his whole identity depends on this recitation of Veda. He merely recites Veda without bothering for the meaning of the Veda, without bothering for the samskara which the Veda is supposed to give. So that is the type of Veda scholars we see. Not many people are say proficient in this meaning of Veda. For example, there is what is called Veda Bhashyam. Veda Bhashyam written by whom? Sayanacharya. Sayanacharya, it is another name for sage Vidyaranya. Vidyaranya was the minister. So in that Kakatiya Empire, you must remember the historical Vidyaranya also. Historical Vidyaranya, he was the minister at the time when the Muslim ruler from Delhi, he came and conquered this Orugallu that is now present day Warangal. He captured the king there, and then he took him there. And then the two princes were there, Harihara and Bukka. So the Muslim rulers, they converted them to Islam. And so at that stage, this man, we do not know what are the finer details, he got them reconverted to say Sanatana Dharma. And then he took them and then established the empire at that Hampi, that is Vijayanagara Empire in the present day Karnataka. So present Hampi is in what state? Is it in Bellary district or some district there? Okay, so there he established that empire, and then he, on one side he was sitting on a horseback and he was also fighting, he was participating in the wars, and at the same time he and his brother Sayanacharya, they wrote this Bhashyam, the commentary for all the four Vedas. So that is the phenomenal work of this Vidyaranya. It is otherwise called Vidyaranya Bhashyam. In Andhra area, we call it Vidyaranya. In North India, it is more popularly known as Sayanacharya. Some people say that Vidyaranya and Sayana are brothers. We are not very sure. So, but Sayanacharya was also a minister. He was also a minister in the court of that Vijayanagara Empire. So, that is the background. So, why I told this is, the people who read this Veda Bhashya are very few. So, Veda Bhashya means, we are also going to see the word Veda Angani. There are six angas for the Vedas. So six angas means six auxiliary subjects, or rather which associate subjects which are needed for understanding the Veda. Suppose you have got an English textbook, a strong, very classical English, let us say. In order to understand it, you need a dictionary. You need a good dictionary which explains all these figures of speech and various other things. You also need some other, you have to have some knowledge of grammar also, because the dictionary does not tell about grammar. So likewise, for understanding the Vedas, six auxiliary sciences, let us say, have emerged. And those are, you must have heard the names Shiksha, Vyakaranam, Chandas, Nirukta, Jyotisha and Kalpam. So Shiksha is the primary one. I am telling because that Vedanga, there is a reference to Vedangas. So that is why I am telling you what this Veda Angas are. Veda Anga means the parts of the Veda, the limbs of the Veda, the six limbs of the Veda. What are they? Number one is Shiksha. Shiksha, in Telugu we use the word wrongly. Shiksha, we use the word to mean punishment. Shiksha does not mean punishment. For a long time I also did not know the meaning of this Shiksha. Till I read this Paniniya Shiksha, till I learned Sanskrit, I was also thinking that Shiksha means punishment. So Shiksha is not punishment, Shiksha is education. Shiksha is basically linguistics and phonetics combined. And how you have to pronounce a particular word, what sort of stress, if it is a stressed syllable or an unstressed syllable, also some elongated syllable. We saw one or two words, something like that, Upanishada, something like that. So that is what is called Plutam. So what is Rasvam, what is the Dirgham, what is Plutam, that is what is called Matra. And what should be the Balam? So all the Balam is the type of stress which you have to give on a particular word. All those things, they are very, very clearly explained in that Shiksha. Then Vyakaranam. Shiksha is one, the first limb. Then Vyakaranam. Vyakaranam is grammar, the Vedic grammar. So that is one aspect. Vyakaranam, one is supposed to know what is the linga, vachana, vibhakti, etc. Then Shiksha, Vyakaranam, Chandas. Chandas is the third limb. Chandas means prosody. The Vedic, particularly the Rig Veda, is having all these ruks. All these ruks are in some particular type of prosody, meter, let us say. All this meter, in English we say pentameter, tetrameter, etc., etc. So something like that, we have got this Gayatri Chandas, Anushtup Chandas. So all these different types of Chandas are there. In, of course, modern poetry you find, modern means the classical Sanskrit, you find Shadula, Matteva, various types of prosody are there. So like that, the Chandas is something which is another branch. Shiksha, Vyakaranam, Chandas. Then Nirukta. Nirukta means the etymological derivation of all these words. After all, you say about 5-6,000 years ago or maybe much earlier when this language developed and then when all these Vedas were composed, then each word has been derived from some particular root. Particular dhatu, as it is said, that particular dhatu or root. So how that word is derived, and that particular root, it is referring to, it is giving various other meanings. So for example, the word go has at least say 8 to 10 meanings. If you see that nirukta means that etymology. So that nirukta, for the purpose of Vedas, was written by one very ancient writer called Yaskacharya. It is called Niruktam. Niruktam, which is written by Yaska, sage Yaska. So Nirukta is one. Then Jyotisham. Jyotisha does not refer to astrology, which we see today. Jyotisha means astronomy, not astrology. Jyotisha refers to that astronomy where, for performance of yajnas, etc., they had to see the position of the stars, they had to see the constellation, they had to see what exactly was the tithi, etc. And this knowledge of astronomy was very strong in all our sages. So this is actually one thing which is helping the modern day astronomers and also researchers in trying to know the time of Mahabharata, the time of Ramayana. Because in Mahabharata, for example, there is one professor in some American university, an Indian, his name is Subhash Kak, K-A-K Kak. You can even see his name on the internet. So this gentleman has written a very huge work, book on the date of Mahabharata. And this dating of Mahabharata is done based on various references which are given in that text. So when this Pattabhisheka of Dharmaraja took place, Pattabhisheka means this coronation of this Dharmaraja took place. So the sun was like this, the moon was like this, various stars were like this, some sort of that description will be there. So all these astronomical features were described in different contexts. So when so and so was born, when Krishna was born, okay, this was the constellation. so Ashtami day, and then when this particular nakshatram was there, and when this nakshatram was in that particular Rashi. So that may take place in 1,000 years or 2,000 years, we do not know. So that's by doing this type of calculation, they are able to find out what is the date of Mahabharata, what is the date of say Ramayana, etc. So this Jyotisha is, lot many such things are found in Veda also, and many people have done research. It is a branch in itself. So Jyotisha, then Kalpa. Kalpa is the last one. Kalpa is the practical application of all these Vedic mantras. How exactly you have to perform a yajna, what sort of yajna vedika, you know the yajna vedika, the small dais is made and then some sort of all bricks are put, and then the brick, what should be the size of the brick, what should be the shape of the brick, and then how all those bricks have to be assembled, in what form. Sometimes it will be in the form of an eagle, sometimes it is in a square, sometimes it is in round shape. So different various forms are there depending on the objective of this yajamani, depending on which deity he is invoking, all these things. So that is what is called Kalpa. So these are all the six angas. The phonetics and linguistics is one, the Vyakaranam grammar is the next. Chandas, prosody is the one, Chandas, Nirukta, that is etymology, is another one, Jyotisha, astronomy is one, and then this mathematical calculations, etc. This Shulba Sutra, there is what is called Shulba Sutra in this Kalpa, that is various mathematical derivations are also there. For example, there is one scholar in Mumbai, Powai, IIT campus Powai, his name is Professor Ramasubramanian. There is one Professor Ramasubramanian who is in the Department of Physics in IIT Mumbai. So this man has done a lot of research on these Shulba Sutras, and then he has established how our people, they were very much aware of Pythagoras theorem and many other theorems which were later seen in Euclid's geometry. So this Ramasubramanian has very conclusively proved, and then he has also done a lot of research in this Vedic astronomy. That is what is that Jyotisha. So this Professor Ramasubramanian. So some modern people, they are also doing some research in this field. So for that, a knowledge of Sanskrit is required, knowledge of English is required, knowledge of astronomy is required, knowledge of science is required. And luckily that gentleman, he is a very highly knowledgeable person in Vedas and Vedangas. His father is a very great Sanskrit scholar. So that is how he has traditionally imbibed all those things. So that is one thing. So these are the Veda Angas. But then all these no doubt are great. I have described all these in such glorious manner now. But then all these are only means. They don't come into the field of jnana. Jnana is something which is an awareness, which is an understanding that tattvamasi. If you have understood it, you don't require Vedanga, you don't require all these things. You may be performing it as a part of Loka Sangraha. That's a totally different thing. But then you are not doing it with the sense of karta, that is kartrutva bhavana. So that is where we were. So this line I think we read, kintu brahma vidya prapt upaya abhiprayena. Upaya, I also explained to you what is an upaya. Upaya is not a necessary, it is not a necessary integral part of a thing. But then it is only a sort of helping, it gives a helping hand. It is only a means for chitta shuddhi or purity of mind. So vedaihi tadangaischa sahapathena samikaranad tapah prabhutinam. This tapas etc. they have been read along with this Vedangas, but still they are only the means, including the Veda. So who can say so boldly, except Shankaracharya, nobody can say so boldly, because if you are making a comment on Veda, it requires tremendous amount of clarity and understanding. Tremendous amount of conviction about not only conviction, this very clarity, first of all clarity in understanding. So he says all these things, they are only upaya. Upaya means upadeya api heyaha. You use it. After you use it for some time, like your detergent, after that you have to get rid of it, isn't it? So that is what Shankaracharya says. We have to read this line. Let us read. Nahi vedanam शिक्षाद्यंगानां च साक्षाद् ब्रह्मविद्याशेषत्वं तत्सहकारिसाधनत्वं वा संभवति. So this is a very very emphatic statement which is being made by Shankaracharya. This Veda शिक्षा आदि अंगानां च एक्सप्लेन टू यू व्हाट आर ऑल दीज अंगास वेदांगास शिक्षा व्याकरण एट्सेट्रा सो फॉर ऑल दीज देर इज नो शेषत्वम शेषत्वम मीन्स द स्टेटस ऑफ बीइंग ए शेष द स्टेटस ऑफ बीइंग ए लिम सो दट शेषत्वम दट स्टेटस इज नॉट देर देन साक्षात ब्रह्म विद्या शेषत्वम It is not a sakshat upakari. It is arad upakari. This word sakshat also is important. Sakshat means directly. It is not directly contributing to that, but very remotely it is contributing to that. That is when you go out, you take your bath and go. That means, which means that you are not taking the soap along with you or the foam along with you. Then, sheshatvam tat sahakari sadhanatvam va. It is not even a sahakari sadhana. Va sambhavati. It is not possible. Then the Purvapakshi is again insisting. So he is coming again. He is giving another example. Let us read. Saha patitanam api. Yatha yogam vibhajya. Viniyogasyaditi chet. Yatha suktavaka anumantrana mantranam. Yatha daivatam vibhagaha. Tatha tapaha damaha karma satyadinam api.
ब्रह्मविद्याशेषत्वं
तत्सहकारिसाधनत्वं वा इति कल्प्यते ओके सो दिस सहपठितानामपि दो यू से दट ऑल दीज थिंग्स आर रेड टुगेदर एंड देन ऑल दीज थिंग्स दे बिलोंग टू वन कैटेगरी सो वाई शुड यू थिंक दट ऑल दीज थिंग्स दे बिलोंग टू वन कैटेगरी Or all of them are in one status. Why are you grouping this? You have a proverb in Telugu. You are mixing up this, say what is this, donkeys and horses. You can't mix up donkeys and horses. So you have to distinguish. So though all these things are read together, they may have different status. Why don't you analyze? Why don't you examine? That is what the Purvapakshi says. You are saying that even Veda, of course Shankaracharya when he refers to Veda, he is referring to the Purvabhaga of Veda. He is not referring to the Uttarabhaga, that is Upanishad. After all, the Upanishad also is Veda, isn't it? So, that Upanishad Vakya, he is not referring to that. He is referring to the Purvabhaga of Veda, to that where that Karmakanda and Upasana Kanda. So, here the Purvapaksha is, Sahapathitanam api, though all these, for all these things which have been read together, Sahapathitam. Sahapathitam means read together. For all these things which are read together, Yatha Yogam means depending on the context, depending on usefulness, yatha yogam, depending on the usefulness, depending on the context, vibhajya, vibhajya means having classified them, having classified as what, whether it is a upaya or whether it is a shesha or whether it is a sahakari, so that manner. So Shankaracharya in the earlier passage he said, all those things they don't merit to be called either shesha or sahakari, so that is what he said. But then the Purvapakshi says, no, all these things, okay, you are dismissing. But then you told about three things. One is Shesha, one is Sahakari, and the other is Upaya. So you try to distinguish. There may be something. You are throwing out everything. Don't throw out everything. So that is what is the Purvapakshi's insistence. Yatha yogam vibhajya vinyogasyad iti chet. And he is also giving an example. Yatha suktavaka anumantrana mantranam. Suktavakam. Suktavaka is actually a collection of suktas, Rigveda suktas. Suktavaka, a collection of Rigveda suktas. Anumantrana mantranam. Anumantranam is when so many deities are invoked in a particular yajna. So for this, of course, a very more familiar example will be our own Satyanarayana Vratam. When you do Satyanarayana Vratam, what do you do? Initially, you do this Ganesh Puja. Then you also do this Navagraha Puja. You put up all those Navagrahas, these nine Grahas, and then you invoke all of them. Then later, you do this Satyanarayana Vratam. Or you take up some other function like Gruha Pravesham. In that Gruha Pravesham, again, you do this Ganapati. You do this Navagraha Puja. You also invoke this Vastu Purusha, etc., etc. You invoke some other gods. And then you do this Gruha Pravesha, isn't it? So, for every ritual, you are not focusing on only one, you are focusing on several accompanying deities and all that. So, in the case of Yajna, of course, we are not very sure about Yajna, we don't know much about Yajna. So, I am giving a familiar example of Satyanarayana Vratam, Gruha Pravesham, marriage, etc. Even marriage, marriage from for our purposes, it is a yajna. An Indian typical Hindu marriage is something like an yajna, where you are invoking all these deities. There you are invoking even the Pitru Devatas. There is what is called Nandi Shraddha. In that Nandi Shraddha, you are invoking the Pitru Devatas from both sides. And then those Pitru Devatas of three generations, they are also supposed to be watching this marriage. You must be aware of it. So, Nandi Shraddha. So we are invoking so many people. And when all these people are invoked, depending on who is invoked and who is being sent back, that is, sent back means farewell, for whom you are bidding farewell, that is also Anumantranam. Anumantranam has two meanings. One is, if you see, I saw that in the dictionary, consecration, that is invoking a person and then making that whole function sacred. So that is what is one meaning. The other thing is bidding farewell also, that is what we call say visarjana, devata visarjanam. So that meaning also is there. Suktavaka anumantrana mantranam yatha daivatam vibhagah. Depending on the say purpose, depending on the deity, depending on his role, etc., you are dividing those mantras and then you are either welcoming him or bidding farewell to him. So likewise, you also see whether all these tapas, damas, damaha and all these things, whether they fall into Shesha category or Sahakari category or Upaya category, and then do some such analysis, don't throw them away. So that is what he says. So yatha daivatam vibhagaha tatha tapo dama karma satyadinam api. Tapa, dama, karma, satyam, for all these things, brahma vidya sheshatvam, either you decide whether it is a shesha or sahakari sadhanatvam va, or whether it is becoming a sahakari, iti kalpyate. So that you please decide. You can decide whether it becomes a shesha, that is a part, an integral part, or whether it is somewhat a secondary accessory. You please decide. Then let us read Vedana. Is it clear to some extent?
Yes.
Because we are not very sure about the yajna process, because I never performed yajna. So Vedanam tadanganam cha.
Vedanam tadanganam cha.
Arthaprakashakatvena.
Arthaprakashakatvena.
Karma atmagnyanopayatvam.
Karma atmagnyanopayatvam.
Ityevam.
Ityevam.
Hyayam vibhago. इत्येवं हि अयं विभागो युज्यते अर्थसंबंधोपपत्ति सामर्थ्याद् इति चेत्. ओके, सो फॉर ऑल दिस वेदास एंड वेदांगास आल्सो वेदानां तदंगानां च. सो अर्लियर ही टॉक्ड अबाउट तपस् दम कर्म एटसेट्रा. नाउ ही इज कमिंग टू दिस अगेन. पूर्वपक्षम इज कंटिन्यूड. सो वेद एंड द लिम्स ऑफ द वेद, all those things, they are also very, very helpful. Just now we discussed that this Vedangas, they are very, very helpful for knowing the meaning of this Veda, how the Vedic mantras have to be applied in various situations. All these things, they are most essential for somebody who is performing a yajna. There is all these Mimamsakas. In fact, strictly speaking, most of the people now, they do not know. Very, very few Ganapatis, they are experts in this Shadangas, the six limbs. They are called Salakshana Ghanapati. You must have heard this word, Salakshana Ghanapati. Salakshana Ghanapati is one who knows the Veda, the meaning of the Veda, who has also knowledge of these six limbs. It is only then he can be called a Salakshana Ghanapati. So you just mention a particular mantra, he will tell you what is this pronunciation, how, whether it is, what is the matra, what is the balam, what sort of the grammatical nuances he will tell, and what is the chandas he will tell. So whether there is something related to Jyotisha, etc., that also he will tell. In which, yajna it has to be, used, and how it has to be used, to invoke which god, which deity. So all these things he should be able to say. So he is something like an encyclopedia. So such encyclopedias luckily are still there. Of course, there were lot many people earlier. Now, of course, we can only count them on fingers. Very recently, one gentleman called Sarashana Ghanapati was one gentleman. So that elderly gentleman, he died at the age of 90. Sannidhanam Lakshminarayana Sharma. Very recently, that gentleman died. Now, of course, there are only a few people in the whole of Andhra Pradesh. They can be counted on fingers. So this Salakshana Ghanapati is one who knows all these Vedangas. So here he says, Vedanam tadanganam cha artha prakashakatvena. So these actually, they are going to give the meaning. they are going to explain the meaning. Artha prakashanam. Prakashanam means explaining the meaning. Artha prakashakatvena. Karma atma jnanopayatvam. So it is not only useful for karma, it is also useful for atma jnana. Why do you dismiss them? So that is what he says. Karma atma jnanopayatvam. That means upaya both for karma, upaya both for atma jnana. So karma jnana upayatvam ityevam hi ayam vibhagah yujyate. This sort of vibhaga, this sort of analysis, classification is very very appropriate. Artha sambandha upapatti samarthyat. Because this Vedas and Vedangas, they are actually giving you the meaning. Artha sambandhi, they are actually related, very much related, because they are going to explain the artham, explain the meaning of these Vedic sentences. So that is what he says. Iti chet na. So the Siddhanti, that is Shankaracharya, says na. Let us read na.
Na.
Ayuktehe.
Ayuktehe.
Nahyayam vibhago ghatanam pranchati.
Nahyayam vibhago ghatanam pranchati.
So this is a very very pithy statement which Shankaracharya makes. First of all, this is Sangrahavakya. This nahi ayam na ayuktehe. Ayuktehe means there is no yukti, there is no logic in what you say. Yukti means logic. So Shankaracharya makes use of Shruti, Yukti and Anubhava, all the three, in order to counter the opponents. So here he says it is ayukti, it is not logical. Then nahi ayam vibhagah ghatanam pranchati. This particular pranchati, this particular type of division, vibhaga means division, ghatanam pranchati, it doesn't happen. Ghatana means happening. Ghatanam prancha na pranchati means it does not happen, it cannot happen. It cannot happen rather. Nahi sarva kriyakaraka phala bheda buddhi tiraskarinya.
Sarva kriyakaraka phala bheda buddhi tiraskarinya.
Brahmavidyayaha shesha apeksha sahakari sadhana sambandhova. Yujyate. So this is an explanation. Nahi. So this Brahma Vidya, what type of, what is the nature of this Brahma Vidya? Brahma Vidya is Sarva Kriya Karaka Phala Bheda Buddhi Tiraskarini. Tiraskarini means that which rejects. Tiraskara. Tiraskara means rejection. It rejects. Rejects what? All types of action. Sarva Kriya. All types of action. When once is Kriya is rejected, then Karaka, Phala, everything is rejected, isn't it? Karaka means that relationship I just now in the beginning I explained. The relationship between the noun and the verb, that is karaka. Kartru karaka, karana karaka, karma karaka, etc. etc. So all those things, they don't arise at all. So all this action, karaka, when the action is not there, there is no phala. So that bheda buddhi. So karma is basically dependent on the notion of duality. It works in the plane of duality. So when you are not in the plane of duality, how can you again say bring that man back to the plane of duality? So this of course is a thing which we have discussed even in earlier Upanishads. That is when we discussed Kathopanishad also we discussed. And then again in Gita Bhashya in some places we have discussed this. So this word also, this phrase we have seen earlier also. Kriya karaka phala bheda mardanam etc. etc. So here bheda buddhi tiraskarinya, that is by rejecting. This Brahma Vidya is something which rejects all these things. Then for such a Brahma Vidya, shesha apeksha na yujyate. Shesha apeksha means the requirement. Apeksha means the need. Apeksha is the need. The need for an angam. Shesha apeksha means the need or the requirement for an anga or a limb. Or shesha apeksha sahakari sadhana sambandhova. It does not require any other sahakari also. Jnanam is on a totally different plane. When you are on a totally different plane, how can you come back to the plane of duality? So all this karma, sahakari, then the sahakari sadhanam, whether it is a shesha or whether it is a sahakari, whether it is an integral part or whether it is an associate part, both these things operate in the plane of duality. So these two things cannot say fit in, these two things cannot combine. So sambandhova yujyate. Then sarva vishaya vyavrutta pratyagatma vishaya nishthatvaccha
brahmavidyayaha
tat phalasya cha nishreyasasya. So this brahmavidya and also its phalam nishreyasa. the Brahma Vidya's phalam, the result of Brahma Vidya is Nishreyasa. Nishreyasa means moksha or liberation. So what is the nature or what is the characteristic of this Brahma Vidya and also the characteristic of moksha? This is Sarva Vishaya Vyavrutta. So you have just withdrawn. Vyavartanam, you know, Vyavartanam is withdrawal. Vyavrutta means it is withdrawn. Sarva Vishaya Vyavrutta, it is withdrawn from all these worldly things. So withdrawal from all the worldly things. Then Pratyagatma Vishaya Nishtha. So you have withdrawn from all the external things and you have looked inwards. Kaschid Dhiraha Pratyagatmanam Aishat. So he is at that stage. Pratyagatma Vishaya Nishtha. Nishtha means Nishayena Avasthanam. That is, you are in that state of, say, awareness of that Pratyagatma. You have learned, you have realized that Pratyagatma, the nature of that Pratyagatma, and then you are firmly settled in that notion. So when you are very firmly settled in that notion, that is called Nishtha. Nishayena Avasthanam, a firm understanding, a firm settlement in a particular notion. So that is that Pratyagatma Vishaya Nishtha. You are in that Nishtha. So for that person, all this, he has withdrawn from all these external, worldly objects. Then moksha, then he is quoting one from some shruti, from some smruti rather. That book also does not give any reference where it is from. I could not find it. So mokshamichyan sada karma.
Mokshamichyan sada karma.
Tyajedeva sasadhanam.
Tyajedeva sasadhanam.
Tyajataiva hi tad jneyam.
Tyajataiva hi tad jneyam.
Tyaktuhu pratyak param padam.
Tyaktuhu pratyak param padam.
Of course. Of course, this meaning is there in several other places in the Mahabharata and in several other places. The meaning is like this. Mokshamichyan, a person who desires this moksha, a person who desires this liberation. So such person, sada karma tyajedeva. So he has to necessarily, sada means always, but here of course we can take the meaning necessarily. Necessarily, karma tyajedeva, he has to jolly well give up all karma, sa sadhanam, and all its sadhanas, karma and its sadhana. Karma involves several other sadhanas. So all those sadhanas means not this yoga sadhana, etc. You can also take that also, it doesn't matter. Karma sa sadhanam, along with all other sadhanas, all other accessories belonging to karma, all those things one has to necessarily give up. So by a person who is a mumukshu. Moksha ichha means mumukshu, isn't it? Then tyajata eva hi tat jneyam. So because, he means because, tyajata eva, by that person who is, say, rejecting, who is doing that tyaga. So here is karma tyaga. Tyaja, the dhatu tyaja means karma tyaga. So tyajata eva, by the one who is doing that karma tyaga. Tyajata, it is in Tritiya Vibhakti. That is, by the one who is doing that karma tyaga. Tat jneyam. Tat means that. That means that Atma, that Brahman. Jneyam, it becomes known. That Atma becomes known to a person who is giving up like that. Tyajataiva hi tat jneyam. Tyaktuhu pratyak param padam. Tyaktuhu. Tyakta is the person who rejects. So tyaktuhu is in Shashti Vibhakti again. Tyaktuhu pratyak. That is, that inner self of that very self, the tyakta, the inner self of the person who is relinquishing. The inner self of the person who is relinquishing is only known to that person who is actually giving up all these external things. So that is the overall meaning of this. Pratyak param padam, that supreme padam, that supreme sthanam, that supreme attainment. Padam means attainment. Padam means two things. Padam means a place and also an attainment. That param padam is that supreme attainment. That supreme attainment is Atma, Atma Jnana. That is what is realizing it as Brahma. So that is the meaning. So tasmat karmanam sahakaritvam,
karmanam sahakaritvam,
karma shesha pekshava,
karma shesha pekshava,
na jnanasya upapadyate,
na jnanasya upapadyate.
So this karmanam sahakaritvam, so you don't require this say karmas as either as a sahakari or as a shesha. Karma Sheshapeksha. Sheshapeksha means the need for karma as a limb. That is karma sheshapekshava. Na jnanasya upapadyate. It doesn't arise at all. That question does not arise at all. Then Tataha Asadeva. Suktavaka Anumantranavad.
Yathayogam Vibhaga Iti.
So Tataha, therefore, Asadeva. It is just not correct at all. That is what you have referred to about that Suktavaka Anumantrana. That is that collection of Suktas in one place, and then you are invoking different deities, and then depending on the deity, whichever mantra has to be used, you have to use. All that type of division, that does not arise here at all, because you are on a totally different plane of non-duality. You are on a totally different plane of awareness. And then when you talk about karma and all that, you are talking about so many deities, so much of duality. So how can these two fit in? So Suktavaka Anumantranavat, just as in the case of this yajna, where you invoke different deities and different types of farewells and welcomes and farewells, so that Yathayogam Vibhagaha Asadeva, that sort of division, Yathayogam, depending on the context, division, etc., all that thing is asat. It is all false. It is all incorrect. Here, of course, incorrect. Then, Tasmat.
Avadharanarthataiva.
Prashna Prativachanasya Upapadyate. Yetavatyevayam. Upanishad Ukta. Anya Nirapeksha Amrutatvaya. Okay, Tasmat, therefore, Avadharanarthata Eva Prashna Prativachanasya. So he is going back to that mantra. In that mantra, there is a Prashna, there is a Prativachana. That is, there is a question, there is an answer, isn't it? The question is, Oh sir, tell me Upanishad. The Upanishad has been told to you. And that Brahmim Vava Upanishad Abhrumeti. In fact, I have told you not any inferior thing. I have told you that Brahmi Upanishad only, something relating to Brahman only, I have told you. So that is what he said. So Prashna Prativachanam, it is final. That is Avadharanartham. Avadharana means, that is a conclusive thing. Avadharana, of course, here in this context, Avadharanartham is, Avadharana is conclusive. It is a sort of concluding statement. So that concluding statement, from that point of view, or from that sense only, we have to take Avadharanarthataiva Prashna Prativachanasya Upapadyate. So this Prashna and Prativachanam, the question and answer, has to be understood as Avadharana. It is something, a final statement. There is nothing further. If at all something further is to be told, it has to be understood in a slightly different context. So that is what is the meaning. Then Yetavatyeveyam. Yetavatyeveyam is Yetavati Eva Yam. Upanishad is Srilinga, we know. Upanishad, the word Upanishad is feminine gender. So that is why the pronoun Yam. Yam is the pronoun. Yetavati Eva Yam Upanishad Ukta. So to this extent only this Upanishad is told. Upanishad Ukta Anya Nirapeksha Amrutatvaya. For attaining that Amrutatva, this is Anya Nirapeksha. No other thing is needed. Anya Nirapeksha means no other thing is needed for understanding this, for this particular knowledge. This Upanishad means this Brahma Vidya. Yetavati eva iyam Upanishad. Upanishad here means Brahma Vidya. For this Brahma Vidya, there is no other thing which is needed. Amrutatvaya. So here ends the 7th mantra. So let us read the 8th mantra. Tasyai tapodamah karmeti pratishtha.
Tasyai tapodamah karmeti pratishtha.
Veda sarvangani.
Satyamayatanam.
Okay. Tasyai tapodamah karma iti pratishtha. So tasyai is referring to the earlier mantra. In the earlier mantra, he talked about Upanishad. Upanishadam abruma. What is that last line of that last mantra? Upanishadam abruma. We told you the Upanishad. And now the word is tasyai. For that Upanishad. For that tasyai means for that. अगेन फेमिनाइन फेमिनाइन से व्हाट इज दिस प्रोनाउन से तस्यै तपः दमः कर्म इति प्रतिष्ठा 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 इज बेस द पेडेस्टल द बेस द फुट ऑन विच द होल स्ट्रक्चर स्टैंड्स द पेडेस्टल ऑन विच द होल स्ट्रक्चर स्टैंड्स सो प्रतिष्ठा प्रकर्षेण तिष्ठति प्रकर्षेण स्थितः प्रकर्षेण तिष्ठति प्रकर्षेण स्थितः दैट इज व्हाट इज कॉल्ड प्रतिष्ठा वेल सेटल्ड वेल एस्टैब्लिश्ड सो दैट इज अ पेडेस्टल इट इज ओनली व्हेन द पेडेस्टल इज स्ट्रांग दैट द आइडल विल से आइडल और व्हाट एवर स्ट्रक्चर आर द बिल्डिंग और द होल एडिफिस विल स्टैंड अदरवाइज द एडिफिस विल कोलैप्स इजंट इट सो दिस तप दम दानम एट्सेट्रा दैट इज समथिंग लाइक द बेस दैट इज द बेस रिक्वायरमेंट दैट इज द बेस लेवल रिक्वायरमेंट ऑन दैट ऑफ कोर्स दैट इज नॉट एनफ If you build, if you lay the foundation only, the house in the house is not over. Foundation is very much needed. But on that foundation, you have to again that do that Shravana Manana. So that we have to keep in mind. So tasyai for that Upanishad or for that Brahma Vidya, tapaha, tapaha we know austerity, damaha that restraint, karma, that karma is action. Then pratish, these are the iti, karma iti. Iti means Some more can be karma adi. This word iti is used in the sense of etc. Karma etc. or pratishtha. These are the base. This is the foundation. This is the pedestal. Then vedaha sarvangani. This veda and sarvangani means all the limbs of the veda. They also form this pratishtha. Vedaha sarvangani. They also form the pratishtha. Then satyam ayatanam. Ayatanam means then Vedas Sarvangani, it is also interpreted as the Vedas, they form the limbs of that whole structure. So that is how also some people have interpreted, but Shankaracharya is not interpreting that way. Vedas Sarvangani also they form the Pratishtha. Satyam Ayatanam. Ayatanam we know. Satyam means here Satyam, not the Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma. Here basically truthfulness. Truthful conduct, normal sense of Satyam. We are not talking in the sense of Supreme Brahman. Satyam, that truthfulness, that is the Ayatanam. Ayatanam means, that is the dwelling place. Ayatanam. We know the word, you must be knowing that word. Yopam Ayatanam Veda Ayatanavan Bhavati. What is that Ayatanavan Bhavati? When you go to your temple, you hear it so many times. Ayatanam. Ayatanam means, there it is a settled understanding. Ayatanavan bhavati, his knowledge becomes settled. So in that sense it is used. So here ayatanam means it is a dwelling place. That is the abode. Abode is a better word. Satyam ayatanam. So that is truthfulness, honesty, truthfulness. Arjavam. Arjavam is the Sanskrit word. Rujuswabhava, the straightforwardness. All these things are the requirement. Amayitvam. Amayitva means lack of deceitfulness. The failure to be deceitful. So he is incapable of being deceitful. So all these things are requirements for this say pedestal to be strong. So that is it. Let us read the Bhashyam. Yam Imam Brahmim Upanishadam.
Yam Imam Brahmim Upanishadam.
Tava Agre Abruma Iti.
Tava Agre Abruma Iti.
Tasyai Tasyaha Uktayaha Upanishadaha. प्राप्त्युपाय भूतानि तप आदीनि
तप आदीनि
ओके याम इमाम तव अग्रे अब्रूमेति ओके दिस पर्टिकुलर ब्राह्मीम उपनिषदम सो द टीचर हैज सेड आई हैव टोल्ड यू दैट द हाईएस्ट फॉर्म ऑफ सीक्रेट ब्राह्मी उपनिषद द हाईएस्ट फॉर्म ऑफ टीचिंग दैट ब्रह्म विद्या आई हैव नॉट टोल्ड यू अबाउट एनी सॉर्ट ऑफ इन्फीरियर आर Aparavidya, I have not taught you any Aparavidya, I have only taught you the Paravidya, the supreme thing, that is that Brahmi, relating to Brahman only. Then, Tasyai, for that, Tasyai means Tasyaha, for that, Uktayaha Upanishadaha, for that Upanishad, Praptyupaya Bhutani Tapa Adini. So, Shankaracharya is again clarifying that tapas, etc. are Upayas. They are the basic, the fundamental, preliminary requirements, not say part and parcel of Brahma Jnana, but these are the preliminary requirements, preliminary aids. Then tapaha kayendriya manasam samadhanam.
Tapaha kayendriya manasam samadhanam.
So tapaha, we know this word tapa. Tapa means there are two meanings for tapa. Tapa means to heat up, to burn. Tapati, Suryaha tapati, burns. So there is a sort of burning from inside. Tapa, the other meaning is alochana. Alochana means thinking. So thinking and this heating up are one and the same. So if you are thinking too much about a problem, your brain becomes hot, isn't it? So tapa is actually related both ways. So tapa is actually straining oneself. Here, of course, not only physically but mentally also. Va kaya indriya manasam samadhanam. So if you want to withdraw from objects, various objects of the external, objects of the world, there is a lot of internal struggle you have to do, a lot of internal struggle, internal strain. You have to convince the mind, you have to tell your mind about this nitya nitya vastu viveka, etc., etc. You have to convince the mind so much, isn't it? All that is tapa. So that is why we hear about the sages. They go into the forest, the rishis and munis, they go into the forest. So and so rishi did tapas for 100 years, so and so did tapas for so many years. So we hear about that. So tapa is a process of this self-restraint. So tapa kaya indriya manasam samadhanam. Kaya is body, indriya means senses, manas mind. So the body mind complex, the whole body mind complex is brought under control. It is kept in a steady state of steadiness. That is what is samadhanam. Samadhanam means that state of steadiness. Samyak adhiyate iti samadhihi. So samadhi eva samadhanam. So then that is the mind is well settled, it doesn't get disturbed. So it is fairly well kept under control. Then
Damaha upashamaha.
Karma agnihotradi. Okay, dama is antarindriya nigraha, we know. Upashama. Upashama means withdrawal from these objects. Then karma agnihotradi. It is very clear. Etairhi samskrutasya. Sattva shuddhi dvara. Tattva jnanotpatti hi drushta hi. Amrudita kalmashasya. Uktepi brahmani. Apratipatti hi. Viparita pratipattischa. Yatha indra virochana prabhrutinam. Okay, so he says, so this tapa, karma, dama, etc. Yetairhi samskrutasya. He means because. Yetaihi samskrutasya. So for the one whose mind has been made samskrutam. Samskrutam means not Sanskrit. His mind has been made samskrutam means his mind has been purified. Samskrutam manaha. That is samyak krutam. That is all the dross, all the dirt has been eradicated. Samskrutam means samyak krutam. That is it has been purified. Samskrutam manaha. Samskrutam means purified. Samskrutasya. Sattva shuddhi dvara. Samskrutasya, it also means you have built up proper samskaras. You have removed the negative samskaras and built up the positive samskaras for such a person. Sattva shuddhi dvara. By this process of sattva shuddhi, by the process of cleaning of this mind, tattva jnana utpatti hi drushta. It is seen that tattva jnana, that is knowledge of the self, dawns in such a mind. Tattva jnana utpatti. Utpatti means rising. That is not exactly generating or producing. Knowledge producing, etc. is not a correct thing. Let us use the word dawning. So this knowledge dawns in such a mind which has been purified, where good samskaras have been built up. Samskrutam manaha. All good samskaras have been built up and all these bad samskaras have been driven away. For in such a mind, Tattvajnana utpatti hi drushta. This arising or dawning, arising also we can use, arising or dawning of this tattvajnana is seen. Is time over?
One more minute.
We can read this line also. Then drushta hi amrudita kalmashasya. And we have seen two things. One, in a purified mind, jnanotpatti, this arising or dawning of this brahmajnana. And in an impure mind, there is a viparita bhavana, there is a wrong understanding, totally improper understanding, totally contrary understanding also we have seen, as in the case of Indra and Virochana. This Indra and Virochana story we heard earlier also in the same Upanishad, we saw earlier. Indra and Virochana, the reference to Indra and Virochana. Indra is the god of, is the head of gods. Virochana is the head of this, say, asuras, the demons, so-called demons. So, asura means asushuramante, those who indulge in sensual pleasures. These people, deva means thinking type. This is the, say, sensual indulgence type. So, this thinking type people, so, amurudita kashayas, amurudita kalmashasya, this kalmasha, kalmasha means this dirt of the mind, all this dirt of the mind, amrudita, it is not mardanam. Mardanam means beating it off, beating it off and destroying. Amrudita means undestroyed. So somebody in whose mind this kalmasha is still left undestroyed, then uktepi brahmani, though Brahma has been told, uktepi brahmani means though Brahma has been told, Brahma has been taught, instructed, then apratipatihi, apratipati means not understanding it at all. Indra did not understand. After all, Brahma Vijna, though Indra was head of the gods and all that, Brahma in the very first instance, he did not understand. So he did again, he went to say Prajapati again and again. So after the fourth time, so three times he goes, and then at the fourth time, he said, then only he realizes this Brahman. So at that time, so that is why apratipatihi. Then in the case of this Virochana, vipratipatihi, that is viparita, viparita pratipatihi, that is totally contrary understanding. So Prajapati told something, this chap has understood something else. So this fellow, he is very happily settled in Dehatma Bhavana. So Prajapati said, okay, look into a water, say, pan, then you see yourself, what is Atma. Then he very happily decorated himself and looked into the water pan, and then he found his beautiful figure. So then he fell in love with that, and then he said, yes, this is Atma. So then Prajapati rightly said, okay, this Atma is the, this Deham itself is Atma. So I have to happily indulge in all sensual pleasures. So he is settled, very happily settled at that level. So because his mind is Amrudita Kashaya, Amrudita Kalmasha. So that is this Kalmasha, this dirt is still left undestroyed in his mind, in the mind of Virochana. So that is what we see, the two contradicting examples have been given, where there is a purified mind and where there is an unpurified mind. So we'll stop here and continue next. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi.